Hello and welcome, everyone. My name is Maggie Gilmore. I'm a librarian at DC Public Library. I am here at the Martin Luther King Jr. Memorial Library. We have some of our wonderful collection behind me here of great cycling titles. And we're going to get started here as our viewers arrive to our virtual environment. If you need captioning for this event, we encourage you to find the auto captioning on Facebook Live or on the YouTube platform. All right, well, we are excited tonight to host our local author, Elizabeth McGowan, and Ursula Sandstrom from the Washington Area Bicyclist Association for our discussion about Elizabeth's new book, Outpedaling the Big C, My Healing Cycle Across America. We encourage everyone to check out this book through our catalog at dclibrary.org. You can find the digital copy on the Libby app through Overdrive. We would also definitely encourage everyone to support their local community bookstores. You can find a copy at East City Bookshop, which is another one of our great partners with DC Public Library, as well as at many of the local bookstores in DC. So tonight, again, my name is Maggie Gilmore. I'm a librarian here at DC Public Library. We have with us as one of our great partners, the Washington Area Bicyclist Association, represented by Ursula Sandstrom. She now serves as the outreach manager with WABA. She's been a great partner with us. She invited us to be part of the Trail Ranger Coffee Hour, where we met some incredible community, book-loving cyclists. And we brought our book bike, so we were able to check out books along the Metropolitan Branch Trail and learn more about cycling infrastructure and how WABA is ingrained in that work here in the district. She also has assisted with the tour to DCPL, which our author, Elizabeth McGowan, has also participated in. Ursula was a marshal for us for a couple of years, so we really love that WABA is able to support the libraries and the libraries are able to support WABA. She's also got some great book recommendations for us this evening, so stay tuned. We hope this program will be somewhere around an hour. As you have questions, please, please feel free to pop them in the comments on both YouTube and Facebook Live. We will see them and then we can push them to Elizabeth, our author, as we go through the program. And at the end, we'll make sure that we've covered everyone's questions. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Ursula.
Thanks, Maggie. Back when we could be in person, DCPL was a fantastic partner in monthly coffee. And it was a great joy to see everyone from DCPL Outreach on the Met branch at 7:30 in the morning on a Friday when it was maybe slightly chilly. Cool. But transitioning to the focus of tonight, I'm excited for Elizabeth's journey and this talk because her journey highlights so well what bicycling means. I mean, riding a bike can be about moving your body, but it's so much more as well. It's joy, it's reflection, it's connection, it's stability, and it's brain support through the ups and downs in mental health. And riding a bike has been all of that and more for me. But the real show here, Elizabeth McGowan is an award-winning energy and environment reporter based here in the district. She's done lots of bike rides, including, as mentioned, DC Public Library's tour to DCPL. Her book, Outpedaling the Big C, My Healing Journey Across America, was published this fall, eliciting enthusiastic quotes from Bill McKibben, Carl Zimmer of the New York Times, and many others. Tonight, the plan, we'll hear an introduction from Elizabeth, and then we'll launch into discussion of the mental, emotional, and physical journeys, the process of publishing her first book, and how public libraries fit into her ride. But that is it for me, Elizabeth.
Okay, so instead of looking at me, I'm going to hold up this copy so you know what my book does look like. I know it's available through the library. They just don't have copies of it yet, or Maggie would have it right behind her. So I'm going to start out by reading, and while I'm doing so, we're going to flash a few pictures that are available in the book, just to give you a flavor of what a little of the journey was like. So here we go. So absorbing a cancer diagnosis from a doctor feels the same as tumbling to the ground from a bicycle, smacking the unforgiving asphalt. It's scary and hurts like hell. You can choose to lie there in a dejected heap, waiting until an 18-wheeler squashes you into roadkill, or pick yourself up and get on with living. I chose to climb back on the bike. In the spring of 2000, I was 39 and had reached a major milestone, 5 consecutive years of cancer-free living. My oncologist in Wisconsin had just given me a clean bill of health after an exhausting 11-year escapade with an insidious type of cancer called melanoma. Most people know melanoma as a skin cancer that can be tamed if caught early enough. What they don't know is how deadly it can be once it penetrates the skin. It will kill 7,230 men and women nationwide in 2019, according to the latest estimate from the American Cancer Society. More than 96,000 new melanomas will have been diagnosed that same year. For years, I had been toying with the idea of cycling from the Pacific to the Atlantic Ocean. Now I had a legitimate excuse, but I wanted my transcontinental journey to be more meaningful than simply checking off an item on a bucket list. I envisioned my undertaking as a fundraiser for cancer research in southeastern Wisconsin, where medical specialists at Waukesha Memorial Hospital had labored so diligently to keep me alive. My ride was also about resilience. I wanted people to see that it's possible to survive the frightening plunge into the black hole of cancer and emerge with renewed physical and mental vigor. That meant being forthright and adept enough to talk about cancer in small town diners, corner stores, health clinics, campgrounds, and people's houses as I explored new territory. For a few shining moments, I wanted to galvanize folks across a horizontal sliver of this glorious, sublime, complicated, and often frustrating country that we all call home. Why would an ordinary recreational cyclist bother to devote an extraordinary effort to engaging in daily conversations about this disease? Well, as corny as it might sound, I believe most people want to be part of the greater good. Sometimes you have to be the one who holds the door ajar. Deep down, we all know that nobody gets out of here alive, but I think most of us have the urge to make our stay, however brief, somewhat memorable. Another reason I was inspired to pedal coast to coast was to pay tribute to the spirit of my father, Ronald McGowan. I wanted that time on the bike to give me the courage to delve into the pain of his death 24 years earlier. Melanoma, the same type of cancer that it wrapped its voracious tentacles around my skin, lymph system, lungs, liver, and abdomen, had dogged my father for decades. It devoured him whole in October 1976, a month after he turned 44. I was just 15. When I received my first melanoma diagnosis as a new college graduate, was it any wonder I figured his fate was mine too? My route included several places where my father and I had spent time together. I wanted my journey to be cathartic so I could understand the complex person I believed he was. My childhood memories seemed too one-dimensional and superficial. I remembered his charm, quick temper, dedication to teaching, and how he minimized being consumed by a disease with no cure. I wanted to expose the connective tissue that bound those disparate pieces. This pursuit would allow me to seek my own truths about my father, because I realized I would never know who I was if I didn't know him. What surprised me is how my journey also let me dig deeply into my grief over his death, deep sorrow I was hardly aware I'd been lugging around since high school. I named my cross-country endeavor Heels on Wheels because the rhyme was catchy and the title was succinct. As my plan took shape, everything seemed perfectly aligned. I had my health, the luxury of time, and the proverbial and mandatory fire in my belly. Every cell in my body was itching to go. Before I could settle into the next stage of my life, whatever that might be, I absolutely had to ride that bike. So I outfitted the bike, fleshed out a fundraising proposal, and settled on a sensible west to east route. Then I started pedaling.
All right. So that is the introduction of Outpedaling the Big C, My Healing Cycle Across America. And having read this book just in the last week, I will say, you know, the introduction leads into the beginning of your journey, even from the point of driving across the country with your husband and preparing to depart, and, you know, sending him off, leaving you alone with your bike. And as I read the beginning of the book, I honestly felt nervous for you. This happened 20 years. I know you're here in good health with us. And I felt this like nervousness of endeavoring to do such a long journey and completely alone. How did you come to decide to take a bicycle ride as your way of fundraising and celebrating being cancer-free and the memory of your father?
Well, like I said in the introduction, it's something I had in the back of my mind. I mean, long distance journeys are something I've done before. I actually hiked the length of the Appalachian Trail. At heart, I guess I'm a minimalist, and those skills of hike backpacking transfer well to cycling. But I have to admit, on the way out to Astoria, Oregon, where the TransAmerica Trail begins, I thought, why didn't I just tell that hospital in Wisconsin I would ride around the state of Wisconsin? Because honestly, that would be a lot easier, because I was looking at some of those landscapes and thinking, holy cow, I'm going to go back up that with gear, right? Because everything I had was in these two panniers and this little tiny pack I had on the front. So I guess part of it was proving to myself that I could do it physically, but the physical part, quite frankly, wasn't maybe as daunting as it's kind of a head game at any long distance trip. And you also have to remember, you don't do it all at once, right? You break it down into days. So my itinerary was very loose. I mean, I knew I needed to get over the Rockies before the snow flew. I started in the middle of August intentionally, so I wouldn't be in Kansas when it was 100 degrees. But I wanted this to be an adventure, and I wanted to be with people and talking about why I was doing this. I mean, there was a lot of solitude because only one person can be on the bike at a time, and I was camping at night. But I didn't carry a stove intentionally because I wanted to interact with people. And I felt, just, you know, having this 5-year cancer-free diagnosis, that it was really important to get the message out that you can also be whole, because everybody I've met has a cancer story, and I was just one. And it was a way for me to engage with people. Small towns, blue highways.
And you said something that we actually talked about when we were preparing for this program, you know, that you can't do it all at once. and that this idea of taking a big, one really big journey and breaking it down into little pieces and just kind of taking a day at a time, a mile at a time, as a way to also approach some of our hardest endeavors in life. And these journeys that we go through, through sorrow and sickness. Is that something that you were aware of before, or?
I guess, on many levels, yes, because I mean, when I was first diagnosed with cancer, I had no idea how long it would last. And the only example I had was my father, and he was diagnosed when I was quite young because he died when I was 15. So his whole adult life was spent, you know, dealing with melanoma on one level or another. So I guess that taught me to engage in life and be in it and not wait for things, but the whole thing about, I guess the lessons come to you. It's not, I don't think we're all born with that. We have to experience it to make some sort of sense out of what you're given, what your life is. And you think, okay, how will I navigate this? And maybe by doing this journey, it gave me something that I could navigate going across the country, and I figured any obstacle that came up, it couldn't be worse than chemotherapy, right? Or lying in a hospital bed after surgery. So I guess we learn to rationalize things and balance things depending on what our story is.
I'm curious. I know for me, I've done some very like small tours, and there was one really big pass that was my like mental like panic, like at like day two of like, oh my God, Middlebury Pass. I don't, but given, you know, the country is very wide, and that was, you know, your journey was thousands of miles. That hesitation of driving down and going, oh, I have to get up this thing by myself. How did that change as you were going through the journey, like physically and also, I'm guessing, also like mentally and emotionally, of the various things that felt scary, or maybe you got better at tamping down the panic?
Yeah, well, that's, I'll tell you all the maps that I was carrying. I had these maps from the adventure cycling, this is the TransAmerica Trail. And it's probably a good idea not to look at the profile maps because they can be daunting, especially when they're like this and you see a 45 degree angle and think, holy cow, I'm not sure about that. And maybe I need to jettison my load. And, you know, here I was carrying these brochures because I insisted on this ride that I do outreach, right? So I had sunscreen coupons and brochures, and they took up a good portion of the pannier. And I thought, wow, I'm going to have to dump some of this weight. Well, of course I didn't do that, but it was somewhat tempting. But you can't, and I'll tell you, in the West, the roads are engineered better because they're newer, right? So we've learned things about it doesn't mean they're easy, but the shoulders are a little wider. You kind of get into a rhythm. The downhills are actually more terrifying than the uphills because you're looking over and thinking, holy cow, I could roll into those rocks and no one would find me for weeks or days, except for the vultures. So you've really got to focus. But it's the East, it's the Ozarks and the Appalachians that are the bear, because there's a very little shoulder and it goes straight up. I mean, these are like roller coasters, up and down and up and down. So by then, I mean, I'm hoping I was more fit, right? You start out and you think you're in reasonable shape, but the journey gets you in shape. And at a certain time, you just figure, you know, you've been through rainstorms, you've figured all of this out. You just muscle through. So that's what I did. And I guess that's sort of what I do in my life. I just figure it out. I figure out how to navigate. And sometimes I stumble a little bit, but I get up and go on.
Not sure where Maggie went there. But kind of going more into the mental health stuff, I know we were talking earlier kind of about what this journey meant as a mental journey and kind of like lessons learned, or how did the being with your own brain for so much of it, especially given the weight of everything you're bringing into the journey of you and your father.
Right. And you know, I started out, this really started out pretty simply. I mean, fundraiser for melanoma research, my $279 bike, and I just wanted to get from the West Coast to the East Coast. And I had no idea I was going to write a book about this. That was not on the list of things. Because I'm a longtime reporter, I'm a word person, and I can't help myself. I have to write things down, right? So that was part of it, was people think, well, what in the world, what are you thinking about all day? Doesn't it get boring? Well, it never gets boring. I mean, I had to focus on the road because some of the scenery is so breathtaking that you can't believe you're seeing it. I mean, you're crying because of all the beauty. And so every time I stopped, I would jot all these things down, because part of it was the hospital had a website where people could, I was this little blue dot that people followed across the country, and I would send them my digital, I would send them entries from wherever I could stop and type up an entry, and photos as well. It was kind of tricky because it was pre-digital era, but we navigated that. So it's the thinking for me, I was thinking, oh my Lord, how am I going to gather all these things up and tell the next story of this segment of the ride? So I had the paper journal, plus I was engaging with people all the time. And if you make yourself vulnerable and you tell your cancer story, everybody has a cancer story. That was part of the joy of the interaction and just listening to people. And that's what I did. I would sit down in a restaurant. Like I said, I didn't carry a stove, so I'd make myself go into restaurants instead of cooking on my own. And that's how you just had conversations and built out this whole, like, it was like a linear community that I built, right? So.
And did people accept the sunscreen that you were handing out?
Yeah, like, it was it was coupons. I thought I was carrying my own coupons because I thought
that's lighter than sunscreen.
Get sick on the way, but it was so it was coupons, and people were very happy with that, and they would read my little brochure, and they would look at me because my cheeks were a little bit rounder on the brochure, and all that writing, it kind of narrows you down. Like, is that the same person? I said, yes, you know, it's the same person. I still have, you know, the freckles and the hair that never looks combed, but because it was helmet hair all the time, right? But I rarely, there were a few little grumpy sections of the country, but for the most part, people wanted to hear more. They wanted to wanted to know what I was doing. So.
And that might be a great spot to ask this question from Rosemarie Burke from Paris. Bonsoir. She's an avid cyclist and asks, were there misadventures? Did anyone roll coal figuratively or literally?
You know, one of the worst things that happened was early on in Monmouth, Oregon. It's not that far into the ride. And I got distracted. You know, I had this little plastic sleeve on my handlebars, and I was looking at where I should turn next. I usually tried to memorize things so I wouldn't have to stare at this map, but I was staring at it, and I went up on a curb. And I mean, I'm telling you, I knew it was not going to go well. My family had camped in Monmouth, Oregon when I was 10 years old. My father had this scholarship with the National Science Foundation, and I had been riding a bike 100 miles an hour with my sister, and I had wiped out. Anyway, so I did it again. You know, I went up on the curb, my bike flew up in the air like a like a bucking bronco, and I landed. And I landed so hard on my arm, I looked around and I thought, oh God, first, I hope no one saw me, because it was kind of ridiculously stupid what I did. But then I kind of wish someone had seen me, because I had to get up and pat myself down and make sure. And I just kind of rearranged my arm on the handlebars. My first aid kit was pretty tiny, but I did have, I think, some ibuprofen or something like that in there. I popped a few of those and I just took a few, and I would stop at these stores and, you know, churches where I camped overnight, and people would give me ice. So I used ice on it for about a week. So, you know, there were a few things. There was one point when a woman, I never had a flat tire, believe it or not, but I did have this bizarre thing happen to my tire. A woman had offered to take my panniers to where I was going to camp that night, but she misunderstood where I was going. So when I got there, my panniers weren't there, and I had to run around, and it, you know, so there were things like that. You think, holy cow, I'm going to have to make the rest of the trip, you know, with whatever, what I have on, which would have been ridiculous. So you just have to roll with it. It's just, you don't have, you know, not things are not at your disposal, because you're on a bike. So you also have to count on the kindness of people.
And I would say, in reading that story about losing your panniers, or they were just misplaced at a different town down the road.
Right.
Rolo Hot Springs, right?
Yeah, exactly.
But it's full of suspense. You're a great, you know, you're a great writer, and you have a sense of humor. You know, I was laughing and while reading, and, you know, it's very emotional, but you just translate that very well. And you obviously have a positive perspective and outlook through this whole journey that I think maybe not everyone would pick themselves back up and just keep going from the beginning of your trip, having injured yourself, to then say, I'm doing this.
Yeah.
I'm doing this.
I know. Well, I've been planning this thing so long. I thought, I cannot let this thing. I mean, here I am. What I'm thinking about is, I can't let people down. I have promised a lot of people I'm going to do this thing. I've got to finish this. So I was not, I mean, unless, you know, part of my body had fallen off, I was going to do this thing. So
here we are in 2020 with COVID amongst us. Among us, and we are grappling with some of the same mental hurdles, I think. So the three of us have been talking how this relates to our current state of mind, mental health, and cycling in general as a subject area.
Right. I know, when we were laughing at the irony of here we are having this conversation about bicycling and outdoor adventures, and we're all sitting in our living rooms or wherever we're fortunate enough to be, right? But these are the times. But like we spoke about earlier, you can still get outdoors, right? And the bicycling, and Ursula can talk about this more, but I mean, I ride my bike regularly. I now live in Washington, D.C., so it's a little bit different. But we have good trails here, and getting out and clearing your head. And it doesn't have to be a monumental journey. You know, I don't have to ride 4,000 miles every time I get on my bike, right? I can just go around town. I can go to a grocery store. But you say, oh, no, I don't want to do that. It's too cold. It's too this. It's too that. If you do it, you just feel better. And not everybody has to do it the same way. You do what you feel comfortable with. That's the key. But it's the fresh air, it's the movement, it's that cycle therapy. And I think it's like putting one foot in front of the other. It's this rotation. It's something that's soothing. And it's like, why do babies fall asleep in the car? Well, because there's some kind of regular movement, and it's soothing, and they just feel better. And for me, riding my bike is cheaper than seeing a therapist, right? So I ride my bike, I walk, and it keeps me whole.
Psychotherapy. So I think we have a book to show you all.
Right. I think Ursula has that title with her.
Yeah, I think we've cued the book. More book recommendations. First, Elizabeth's book. But
yes, after that, we're talking about Outpedaling the Big C, My Healing Cycle Across America by Elizabeth McGowan.
But kind of that broader, you know, this is biking and mental health is kind of well known as one thing that a lot of folks do, myself included, to kind of, you know, be less unstable, okay, you know, kind of depending on the week, especially this year when it has just been, the challenges have just kind of exploded. Let's see, there we go. So Microcosm Publishing does a bunch of amazing bike books. And so psychotherapy is all about specifically grief and healing through riding a bicycle. But we also like, let's see, kind of the broader like body connections. They also published a riff on the classic women's health, our bodies ourselves. I'm looking over at my personal copy of that. And then I just wanted to give one last shout out to burnout. This is not actually bicycling specific, but it is about the stress cycle and what you can do, but through a framing of the world is not equal. You cannot pull yourself up from the bootstraps. There are structural things that may be giving you a harder time compared to others. You know, sexism, racism is real, and it matters when it comes to mental health and what maybe challenges you're facing. And so it also has a great kind of section at the beginning about what moving your body means. And I found for my brain, I have a lot of trust built with this author. And this is, if I need a written reminder of, hey, maybe you should move, this is one way I found for myself that I can read this and go, oh, fine, Emily, I guess so. It kind of explains why some of that brain stuff and science about why journeys like Elizabeth's and just, you know, going to the grocery store or going out for a walk can be more than just, you know, checking a box on physical activity or getting snacks, but can really be part of that like mental and just like keeping yourself okay-ish.
And I will say, you know, yes, it's cold outside, but the benefit of bicycling is that once you get started, you're going to heat up right away.
Right.
So Ursula, how else is WABA supporting cyclists right now? I know you have a lot of events going on.
Yes. Yeah. WABA we're doing a little bit in person this fall, but we have gone back entirely online because of the COVID numbers in our communities. The biggest thing we've launched was a big campaign called Let's Get Rolling. And it is a WABA.org/tips has a bunch of articles as well as links to some webinars we're hosting focused on just riding a bicycle basics, making sure, you know, your bike can stop and start. Coffee hour if you want to talk to a staffer about a particular issue, and a lot of articles about, you know, riding in the winter, riding in the heat when that happens, because we know a lot of folks have started or rejoined riding a bicycle as a way to kind of do something for a lot of different reasons with the pandemic.
Yeah, so WABA supports infrastructure here in DC, cycling infrastructure. I think over the last 10 years, the bike lanes in DC have significantly improved, and our connectivity here in the city. And Elizabeth, do you want to talk about what that means to you as on a bigger scale?
Sure.
From the West Coast to the East Coast.
Exactly. I mean, one of the first things after I did this bike ride, I ended up taking a job here in the district, and I moved here from Wisconsin. My husband and I moved here. And I think the first group I joined was WABA, right? Because supporting bicycle advocacy. So I know the first year, it was 2001 and 9/11 happened, and they had that big long ride, and we didn't do the big long ride. Instead, we went around in a circle somewhere. But WABA, it's about connectivity, right? Bicyclists love to connect things. We like to do loops because going back and forth. I mean, when I got to Virginia, I wasn't going to ride back to Oregon, maybe someday, but not then. So really what WABA does is take this, the DC area and working with groups and governments, it takes everybody to have connectivity so that you can look at a map and see, oh, I can go here, I can go there. And I don't have to, there's not some huge area where I have to get off and, race across 8 lanes of traffic, that kind of thing. So it's about building toward that. And it takes a while, but WABA is very involved in that, and thus my support for them. And it's like a mini what Adventure Cycling, which is out in Montana, where I order my maps from. They have several different routes across the country. You can go, and then you can go north and south. You can go to Canada. You can go to Mexico. There's the, I think one of the women on this call did the East Coast Greenway, she told me. So she went from Canada down to Florida. And so you can do, there are many different ways you can ride a bicycle, and you don't, that's why comparing, you don't have to compare. You do what you want to do. You do what you feel comfortable doing, and then you can pick people's brains. Oh, what was this like? What was that like? Because that's part of the joy in it's not supposed to be a brag festival. It's supposed to be a sharing festival. And it's like talking about a book. You want to welcome different people into the situation, and you don't all have to be the same, right? And I'm not a gearhead. I mean, I just adapted things that I had in my backpack. I'm like, oh, I can use that on my bike. I didn't really want to go out and spend all this money. The hospital printed up that one shirt that you saw in the one photo was a white cotton t-shirt. Cotton is a stupid thing to wear on a bicycle, but it was my town shirt. So after I, pedaled in my really crusty clothes, that, you have a couple outfits, so you're wearing that every single day. And there were times like when I would stop in a church and ask if I could pitch my tent in their yard, I didn't want to wear that. So I would put on my heels on wheels. It was white at one point. It was probably gray when I got to Virginia, but it was about the unity, and that's what this is all about. And this country is evolving to have better bicycle infrastructure. So, if you have a chance to say yes to that, to any group that you belong to or a legislator, then do it, because it's helping everybody on many different levels.
And so this is the TransAmerica route.
Yes.
Recommended, and you had maps for each state.
Yeah, they break it down into sections. So I didn't carry all the maps at once. It's like a setup, I think 12 maps. So I would have several, and it was so exciting when I finished my first map and I could mail that back home. I was like, wow, look what I did. You can't look at all the maps at once. You had to take, because Oregon is a really big state. And anybody who thinks Idaho is a different picture. You go through, part of the stick. It's like, yay, I got through Idaho. But Oregon was, that was a lot of pedaling. And it was, you started out in green, you're the ocean, then it's green, and you go over the mountains and it's beautiful. And then there's a lot of high desert, a lot of high, high, dry desert. So you're adapting to, you see every ecoregion of this country on this ride. And don't forget to get to libraries.
Yeah, let's talk about that. So you have print maps and then you are calling. Yeah, there you go.
So
you're calling like the radio station to give a report now and then. Then you're going to the local libraries to write a blog post.
Right.
Go along.
Yeah, well, thanks for holding up that map, Ursula, because those maps also were a great memory jogger when I'm sitting. So I told you I'm carrying these paper journals, right? I scribble at night in my tent, you know, using my little headlight, and or when I was in a restaurant, it was warm and I could actually, you know, use my hand instead of, I mean, because there were some very cold nights. There were nights with frost, and anyway, but so I would take the paper journals, and I didn't have. I didn't even have a cell phone with me, right? It was the year 2000. I wasn't carrying a cell phone. And so I needed to stop at places where I could type up my journal entries, send them to the hospital. And yes, I was also doing, I would call into this radio station in Milwaukee because they were keeping readers tuned in. I would call in and tell them about whatever my latest adventure was. But so libraries, which, you know, I kind of worship at the librarian altar because they are very helpful people. And I know that they're resourceful. And just one little snippet, we tried to have the librarian from Girard, Kansas, Terry Harley, on tonight, but she's actually recovering from COVID-19. And she also had a conflict, so she couldn't be here. But this is just one example of how librarians helped me on my journey. I pull into this little town of Walnut, Kansas, which nobody, you know, has probably ever heard of, but there was a library. I said, yay. So I went in and I said, can I use your, you know, your public access computer? I mean, I was kind of used to this, to type up this entry. I told them what I was doing. Oh, they thought that was interesting. Well, the bad news was their internet was down. Whoops. So instead I went to the, so then I went to the diner in Walnut where the woman, the librarian's mother worked, because, you know, they both had red hair. I thought, wait a minute, you two have to be related. Well, but the librarian, not to be deterred from Walnut, she called Girard, Kansas for me and said, hey, we have a woman who's, you know, doing this ride. She needs blah, blah. So they worked it out for me. So I go to Girard, Kansas, and here is this Terry, this lovely woman in, you know, and they have a Carnegie Library there. It's a beautiful building. And so she welcomed me. I wrote my journal entry, but nothing would do. But what she said, well, Elizabeth, where are you going to stay tonight? I said, well, you've got this great public park in Girard. So I'm all excited. I can pitch my tent without, you know, causing any kind of distraction for the evening. No, nothing would do but what I was going to stay at her house because one of her kids was at college. So, you know, this was the place where I sat with this family. First of all, she took me to dinner at Mom's Diner because, you know, of course, there has to be a Mom's Diner. And then at her house, we sat around watching Veggie Tales, which were new to me, but they were stories, biblical stories told with vegetables. And I thought, where else? But in Girard, Kansas, would I get to see this? So, I mean, that's just a tiny example. And like I was saying earlier, I really thought I was never going to get out of Kansas because the people there, as I note in my book, are the friendliest people. When they ask how you are, they want an answer and they make eye contact. They're not hoping you just say, oh, I'm fine and pedal on. It was remarkable. And I thought I was going to have to overwinter in Kansas and finish the trip in, you know, spring because I wouldn't get out of the state. So, and that's just part of the library story.
So you are doing this cycling journey in the year 2000.
Right.
Now, here we are in 2020 and the book was published.
Right.
And I want to say, I really like the format of the book, flipping from chapter to chapter between your cycling journey and your personal journey and your family history and, you know, first your father's battle with cancer and then yours. And, you know, the format just works really well for the reader.
Good, good. Because that was hard. And it was, I mean, the, one of the reasons it took so long, which is a little bit embarrassing because I am a reporter and I'm used to turning things around quickly, but this was a more daunting project. And I had many starts and stops, and sometimes I just set it aside because it was too much. But because I'm used to asking other people hard questions, and asking myself hard questions was hard, beyond hard. But so what helped me was realizing I did not want to just do a travelogue. I didn't want to tell people I stopped here and I saw this and I did this, because we have enough of those books and I didn't need to contribute that. So that's why I had to delve into those difficult pieces and put this all together. So I'm glad it worked. It was excruciating, but what helped me living here was connecting with things like the MLK Library and going to your book festival and hearing other authors, you know, lament how hard this is. I mean, this process, I mean, what any writer wants to hear is, wow, when I read it, it flowed, because that, like, I just sat down and it all flowed out. But putting it together is the hard part. So going to that author festival that you have was lovely, because it gave me, it helped connect me to other people, because writers can sit and go into their interior world, and that's helpful when you have to really focus, because you've got to sit and make the words come out. But you also need to get out of your interior world and learn how other people approach this. And, oh, do you have any tips for when you run into this? That was my other cycle therapy, was talking about how to write this thing. Didn't matter what the topic was, those ideas and having access to other people was enormous in getting this thing finished, finding a publisher, realizing I knew I was looking for a niche audience and I needed to find a publisher who would be open to a story like this. And it's
that was hard, because you got the response that you got was, oh, you know, it's another cancer memoir, or it's another cycling memoir. Was it that specific, that publishers just have too many of them?
Yeah. I mean, like the one woman, I went to a different seminar. It's like, oh, it's a memoir, really hard to sell, a cancer memoir, doubly hard to sell. I mean, for a while I thought, holy cow, what have I done? I'm saddled myself with this albatross and I've got to figure out how to market it. So that was, and I knew all those things going in. But once again, it's sort of like getting through the chemo, getting through the surgery, getting over the Rocky Mountains and the Appalachians. I am going to figure this out. So I had to teach myself a new vocabulary. This publishing world was just foreign to me. And I knew how to do magazines and newspapers and online publications. So I had to just ask a lot of questions, go to a lot of conferences, and I kept thinking, okay, all I need is one yes, right? How do I get to the one yes? So.
And when did that one yes come?
Well, the one yes came, let's see, that would have been, it was the best Christmas present ever, because it was December. I sent something, it was this Bancroft Press in Baltimore. I sent something right before Christmas and I got an email back saying, wow, this looks interesting, I'm reading it now. And the next email a few days later was, I'd sent my whole manuscript, was, when can we talk? And I thought, I didn't answer the email right away, because I thought that must have been a mirage. I didn't really see that, because too many times I'd seen something that was really close, but not the yes. So then, of course, we got, it was supposed to come out in June of 2020. The publishing, I thought I was glacial, but their publishing is really glacial and takes usually a year and a half from acceptance and signing a contract to publishing a book. And then, you know, COVID delayed it another 3 months. But at that point, I thought, what's another 3 months when it's been all this time? So here we are.
So you got your yes for Bancroft in 2018?
Right after Christmas, like maybe January of 2019, I think I signed the contract. Right. So, right. But that was a wonderful thing, and I didn't have to have it under the tree. I was happy to get it digitally.
And backing up a little bit, we can answer Peter's question in the comments. And Peter is, full disclosure, also a DC Public Library employee. He put together the blog post that was in the comments a few links back about cycling journeys, if you're interested in other books about bicycle journeys. But Peter is asking, you know, the process of writing and submitting your manuscript. How much did you revise the account of your journey as you were putting it together for publication? So how much of it did you write within the first few years after the ride? And, you know, what was the expansion of it? Was it at, like, what point was it complete in your mind?
Mm-hmm. No, those are wonderful questions, because, you know, somebody said to me, oh, Elizabeth, you should write a book. I hadn't even thought of that. You already have those journal entries and you can use those. And like I said, I didn't want to just do a travelogue. So yes, I had the spine, right? I consider that to be the spine of the geography. But it really, that's why having like a developmental editor is really helpful, to take a look at something and say, you need to add more dialogue, you need to cut these pieces out. But the publisher who accepted it made very little changes. You know, it was kind of proofreading stuff. I'd say that it was by about 2014 or so, I felt I had finally concentrated and put something together that was marketable. And then I did some tweaking. Sometimes I just set it aside. I remember one editor had said, sometimes your best friend is time. Just set it aside and revisit it. But at some point you need another set of eyes to look at it, because you can look at it and you have to work it, but you can't. Sometimes you just need someone else to give you suggestions on how to do that.
So it sounds like past 2014, is that where the DC Author Fest was the kind of transition and getting from a published manuscript to, okay, how do I market and sell this thing?
Because, right. So I went to the ones at the, you know, and here we live in, you know, this embarrassment of riches area, right? So when the MLK library shut down for a little while, they moved the festival down to the Library of Congress, which was lovely. I mean, I don't remember. I went for several years, and I would have gone this year if COVID hadn't canceled it. But yeah, those getting out of my own space, that's exactly right. And just learning what other people did, because you also realize you don't just have to write your own book. You have to market your own book to a degree. I mean, publishers help, but they have a lot of books because there are so many thousands of books published each year. So really, if you don't have a marketing plan in your book proposal, they're not going to listen to you. You have to show that you are willing to get out there and talk about it. And most writers just think that part is somewhat odious, but I think it can be fun. I mean, like a forum like this, if you're engaging people and people can ask questions and you do your best to answer them. So all of the tools in this area can be very helpful. It's a matter of tapping into them. It's like any new thing you're learning. You have to tap in, and you there is no dumb question. You ask away, but really it all circles back to you and your determination. I mean, a lot of people have a book in a drawer. Do you want to get it out of the drawer? Because I wanted to get this thing in the hands of readers. And I guess then when people read the manuscript and said, oh my God, this is pretty good, Elizabeth. Then I thought, oh, I have validation. Now I really want to get this in the hands of readers. So here we are.
And DC Author Festival, for those who have not participated, is a professional working day, kind of, for local authors that the DC Public Library hosts. Like Elizabeth said, we've hosted it at the Library of Congress for 2 years, which just works great to kind of give it some exposure, I think. But it's a series of workshops with local authors just talking about their experiences, whether it's in social media marketing and using Twitter as an author, or if it's in publishing in the ebook industry realm environment, what that looks like, self-publishing, working with an agent, working with a publisher. And it has, you know, been an opportunity for authors to get their books out there and get some visibility. And we have gone to the East City Bookshop. I want to plug them again, where you can purchase Elizabeth's book, East City Bookshop on Pennsylvania Avenue. We had a great author happy hour to host authors to read from their books at the bookstore. So they were just great in supporting DC Public Library's program as well. I encourage all participants to please ask your questions now. We are going to wrap up soon. You can just ask a question in the comments. If you're on YouTube or Facebook, they both work. We can see them. Ask away.
Yeah, fire away. And just to segue into what Maggie was saying about, I really made a point to support independent bookstores, because that's why I had connected with East City and they were willing to carry my book. And, you know, I know that they were struggling. I mean, it's hard enough to run a small business. And then we had COVID and they were trying to do curbside. I mean, it was crazy. But, and my publisher kind of leaned toward, oh, everybody orders from Amazon. And I thought, well, you haven't met all my friends. They don't necessarily want to take that route. And I'm not going to badmouth anything, but I did want to really, you know, support a local grower who could get these words in the hands of people, because we can't just talk about supporting. We actually have to do it. And I know that they have, you know, I'm a smaller book, a smaller publisher. So the supply chain was really gummed up with COVID, but finally it loosened and they were able to get. But I kept dogging them, and they were performing. They stepped up and, you know, they were delivering, mailing, whatever, to get this book in the hands of people. So I just encourage people to think about those smaller businesses that are, you know, providing a service, but they can't provide a service if we don't give them money and, you know, and visit the shop. So
we had a question from Jamie. What was your longest ride before going cross country?
Yeah, that's a really good question, because I had never before had I ridden with panniers. That was my first time with panniers. So I had done Wisconsin. I had lived there for quite a few years. So I'd done a lot of rails to trails up there, but we would like ride out and back. So my longest day had probably been, I'd probably done like, you know, 75 miles. By then I might've done a century, but I wasn't carrying any gear. So that's just a different dynamic. So yeah, that was another thing. It's like, I wasn't taking on enough. I thought, well, I'll carry, you know, 40 pounds of gear, whatever it was that I was carrying. But that's a good question. And it, you know, riders are funny. your pavement is different from riding on a, you know, a rails to trails, and then there's gravel riding. There are all kinds of dimensions, but I was not like a, you know, like a triathlete kind of a rider. I was more of a recreational, but I mean, there were times I'd take long rides, and I remember one time I had to hitchhike with my bike because it had gotten too dark and I didn't have my lights. So I, you know, I guess I was winging it a lot. That's maybe my middle name.
Well, on that note, another question was, were you worried about your safety being alone? Safety, you know, in regards to wayward folks.
I mean, I had hiked. I actually met my husband hiking the Appalachian Trail. So I had started out hiking in Georgia by myself. And I like to think of myself as being savvy. You have to, I guess I was more intimidated by the big trucks, the big logging trucks that would come, and you would be in their slipstream. I thought, I don't want to be in your slipstream. Please get away. Then I never felt uncomfortable, and I never had anybody, you know, yell anything unpleasant, maybe once out of a car window, but it was really the traffic that concerned me. Once I got into towns, I actually felt a sense of relief because I thought, oof. And sometimes there were very intense stretches of highway where I would just pull off for a while and just do some deep breathing, because those the shoulders could be very narrow. And I think that in some places those trucks took great delight in trying to, you know, see how close they could get to a cyclist. So you have to kind of steel your brain for that. You cannot, if that intimidates you, you probably shouldn't do this type of riding, or you'll, I had to let go of that and say, all right, I'm going to do the best I can. It's like turning yourself over to a surgeon. At some point you just have to trust and say, I think I'm going to get through this, and I cannot think about all the scenarios or I'll paralyze myself. So I didn't worry about it. I mean, I ended up dancing the two-step in a bar in Missouri where I stopped and camped, but I felt like all those people in that bar were like, became my, you know, my siblings. They were like a family for the night in the Ozarks. So anyway.
For folks who haven't ridden next to very large trucks, the slipstream is, it's a mass of air from a truck that comes kind of behind it and just like hits you and can kind of shove you sideways, and can really feel like very, A, it's dangerous, and also just like that emotional thing is, there's just so much mass there. I know that's first, I've got a few extra few questions here that are fantastic, but I did want to verbally say that Kathy Cebu is in the comments and said that she's very proud of you, Elizabeth. So I wanted to get that out there. But a fantastic question from Amy is on Facebook is, how was your writing your book different than journalism? What were the biggest challenges and or differences?
Well, that's an excellent question. And it's different because I found what I would often do, I took a writing class at a place called the Writer Center in Bethesda, if people are familiar with that. And we workshopped, I don't like turning those words into verbs, but I just did it because other people do it. But I found that what I would do is I would condense things, because in journalism, it's always the word count. You have to, you know, get rid of the adjectives and the adverbs and boil things down. And what I found with my sentences, I would often have one sentence would contain the fact that I had survived cancer, my father had survived cancer, and I had done this bike ride. And I'm like, okay, I can actually get rid of the commas and write a narrative here. So it's, that was, that was liberating, but also kind of frightening, because we like to have boundaries, right? And I felt like this book didn't have any boundaries other than that I knew I wanted people to turn the pages. But when you're starting out writing, and in journalism, the thing is, you got to type, get it done, and move it along, because the next day something else happens. So you don't have time to linger. And sometimes I wanted that to be the case with this thing. I just write and have somebody else take care of it. But I was the one that had to take care of it. So it was an exercise in learning how to think large instead of so small. I didn't have to do a Reader's Digest. I could actually fill in all the gaps. And that's daunting. I mean, because I was asking myself questions about, what was it like to deal with that cancer? Who was my father? Oh my God, why was he explosive? Well, I delved into his Korean War history. I delved into how he grew up. I delved into him being diagnosed with cancer when he was 21 years old. Then I could figure, having been through all that, I was able to say, well, no wonder he became who he was. So, and I could ask all those things, and I could find a way to put them in the story. Now, I didn't write everything, because then nobody would pick up the book. I didn't need a doorstop. I wanted a book that people would turn the pages. But that's a great question. And it's, I hope I covered some territory that was helpful.
And actually, it fantastically segued into the next question on the docket from Terry of, has your sense of calm or acceptance of your loss of your father stayed with you since that journey has ended? Like, what's since 2000?
That is lovely, because I'll tell you, when I finished this book, I felt lighter. It didn't mean I was eating less. I felt just liberated. And that was part of why I didn't know I was carrying this big satchel around like Santa Claus. I didn't know I was carrying that. And when I got on the bike, I always said, this is about, you know, my cancer story, the journey. And it's a tribute to my father. That's how I started out saying it. And I didn't realize, you know, we did a lot of camping growing up, and the places where I would stop, you know, Yellowstone, I first visited with him. It was those things where those visits that sparked this. And I thought, wait a minute, I think I need to delve into that. Because when you're 15 years old and something happens, well, a lot of us, when we were 15, we thought we knew a lot, right? Don't worry, I've got that. Well, you don't know really anything, but so it was a relief to be able to say, I am going to look at this and I am going to write about it. And I had no idea how cathartic it would be. And I still feel lighter. I mean, and every day I know I think about my father, but I think, wow, I feel as if, I guess, this needed to come out and be part of this book. But it was incredibly liberating, and I had no idea that it would be so liberating. And I don't know if that was grief. I don't know. I'm sure it was a mix of emotions that I was processing that emerged in the way that I know how to do it, because I like to think I have a facility with words. I've been working with them a long time, and I guess that was the avenue I needed to take to relieve. Good question.
And I think a good one to wrap up on is, do you have any other big adventures on your horizon? This is from Kathy E. Seabaugh.
Oh, Kathy Seabaugh. My she's a friend from college. You know, people keep asking me, what's next? And like one woman said to me, I gave a talk about this book up at the Appalachian Trail Museum in central Pennsylvania. She said, Elizabeth, your answer to that question is getting this book out in the hands of readers. Although I have to say, a woman who I hope is on this call talked about doing that East Coast Greenway. And I thought, and as soon as she wrote me that email, I wrote back to her and said, wow, all in one time zone. That's kind of cool. And she said, and plus it's near civilization every day. And I thought, so part of my brain started to churn on, I wonder how I could, but anyway, but for right now it's getting this book out, but that might be on the list.
Let me know if you want to do East Coast Greenway and I can connect you with the staff there. They would be
okay,
enthused.
Okay.
My favorite thing about the East Coast Greenway is that, you know, so DC, the Greenway Trail runs through the region. The Metropolitan Branch Trail is on the East Coast Greenway, but it goes Florida to Maine. So my friends in Maine also commute to work on the East Coast Greenway.
Right.
And
right.
It's this little, like,
it's fun, right?
Connection with, you know, exactly. Josh and my, like, morning commutes back when we were, you know, commuting to work.
Right, exactly.
So I think we should wrap it up for the evening. You have some great supporters in the comments. And again, if you have more questions, leave them in the comments. I think that we'll be checking in on it here and there. And you can follow Elizabeth's author page, is the title of her book, on Facebook. Outpedaling the Big C is her Facebook author page, so follow her there. You can purchase the book from our local bookstores in DC, Solid State Loyalty Books, East City Bookshop. They all have copies. And you can check out a digital copy, or you can at least place a hold on it through dclibrary.org. And we will have print copies on their way soon. If you are interested in other ways that DC Public Library supports our cycling community, visit dclibrary.org/bike. And that's where we post any bike-related programming that comes up or book recommendations. Thank you to Ursula for joining us tonight and being WABA's representative. Visit WABA.org, WABA.org. That's Washington Area Bicyclist Association. There we go. let's see. Did I plug everything we needed to plug?
And don't forget that we hope that next year you're doing your library tour, your bicycle tour that people can sign up
yeah.
for. Right?
Oh, yeah. We'll do another tour to DCPL.
Okay.
And we will do another DC Author Festival, which ideally can happen back at MLK. I am here at the Martin Luther King Jr. Memorial Library, so we are open for limited services. If you want to check any of these books out that we have promoted tonight, you can visit dclibrary.org, search through our catalog, and place holds, and then you can pick up books at any neighborhood library. For the time being.
All right. Well, thank you. Thank you to everybody who was participating and to those who are visible. This was a lovely experience.
Yeah. And thank you, Elizabeth, for pursuing through all of these incredible journeys that you've talked about tonight. Thank you for being here with us. We were really excited when you reached out as a local author, a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist, someone who loves libraries and loves bicycling.
All right. Thank you, everybody.
Yep. All right. We'll say goodnight and thank you very much. Join us next time.
Okay. Good night.